Search Hawaii, Where Food Meets Culture is brought to you by Grand Wailea, a Waldorf Astoria resort on Maui. We live to create extraordinary lifetime memories. With transportation provided by Hawaiian Airlines.
I'm Mike Lofaro, and I'm from Block Island, Rhode Island.
Kainoa Horcajo from the island of Maui.
I'm a professional chef.
I'm a student of the culture. Mike and I met at the Grand Wailea working and just hit it off.
I love anything that has to do with the oceans.
Love spending time in the mountains, getting into the ocean, all of it.
Kainoa had this great idea to do some dinners based on the Kaulana Mahina. I thought it was an awesome idea.
We went on adventures up into the mountain, down to the ocean, and really just started connecting with that.
So I do what I do, Kainoa does what he does, and see how that translates to a plate.
Guided by the moon, but with a modern twist.
It's the ultimate way to connect to the food.
It's a coming together of food and culture.
On this episode of Search Hawaii, we've come to the island of Maui, where Chef Mike and Kainoa will search nature for ingredients to create a one-of-a-kind dinner. We are in the Hawaiian lunar month of Velo, which has to do with the winds. And wait until you see what Chef Mike and Kainoa have in store.
Velo typically happens around April or May in the year. It means to flutter, like in the wind, and this is a windy time, a transitional time in the calendar. And so in traditional times, all throughout Polynesia, and especially in Hawaii, people flew kites, and this was the time to do it. So before we go on our search, we're gonna go have a little fun and get in the wind.
I know Kainoa is kind of an adrenaline junkie, so I'm pretty stoked to see what he's got up his sleeve. Okay, we're gonna get you guys all hooked in here.
Thank you,
we're gonna start
off
with— We get to the paragliding place. And I can't wait to just, why not? Let's go run off a cliff.
The guys from Proflyght are getting us hooked up. Mike and I are getting into the harnesses, clipping around here, clipping around there.
People are taking off in front of us. Abai's got me latched in, and we're just kind of sitting there waiting for our turn, and it's exciting.
Okay, now we're gonna run faster and faster. Keep running. Don't stop running now. Keep running. Keep running.
Dexter tells me the main thing is just to keep running. Even when you think you're done, you just gotta keep on running down that mountain.
So you just start running down this hill, and then you can feel the kite starting to lift you up, and then all of a sudden you're in the air, but you go from being just off the ground to being like incredibly off the ground in seconds. Every time we'd get close, we'd be like, you start screaming at each other, like, yeah, buddy, yeah, you know, I think because we're just both kind of just adrenaline out and so excited.
Hawaiians traditionally use kites for all sorts of purposes, for navigation, for looking at the weather. And Maui the demigod, who the island Maui is named after, was said to have made a kite big as a house to sail in between the islands on his double hull canoe. We're in beautiful upcountry Maui, and before we head down to go get into the ocean, we're gonna go visit Forest and Kim Starr, amazing biologists, avid gardeners who are really cultivating some varieties and some fruits that aren't commonly found in Hawaii.
Mike, nice to meet you.
We meet Forest and Kim, and they immediately start taking us around and just showing just a huge variety of things that they grow on this farm.
Oh, you guys are growing a bunch of different stuff here.
Yeah, we have some wheat here.
You got eggplant and artichokes.
Some elephant garlic.
We're over here checking out what they got growing, and Forrest and Kim offer to give us some stuff for dinner. We're really excited about that because it's just really unique things they're growing.
We've got a pepino dolce you might be interested in.
A what?
Oh. Pepino dolce. Oh. Ooh la la.
That sounds like a luxury handbag. Forrest tells us about this fruit called a pepino dolce.
Here's the fruit.
Oh, wow, that's cool. Some I've never really heard about before. Creepy. Mike has barely heard about it too, and it looks like a tomato, but it smells like a melon.
Right on, Mike. You think you can do something with that?
Absolutely. This is wild.
Yeah.
Just melon. It tasted very much like the most wonderful floral melon that you've ever smelt and tasted. So immediately is just, what would I do with the melon I would do with a pepino dolce?
Here's something you may not see in Hawaii every day. Peach.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Look at that, man.
This is a Florida Prince peach. It was developed by the University of Florida and Texas A&M.
You think of peaches as Georgia and places that freeze and are cold, but there's a bunch of what they call low chill peaches that we can actually grow here in Hawaii, and you'll only find them in the upper altitudes, but to me, it's just mind blowing.
Yeah.
A lot of peaches.
Yeah, I'm actually looking forward to seeing what you could do with these peaches.
Yeah, man, peaches, are you thinking, I just think peach cobbler. And do a dessert?
I don't know. I don't think so. I think immediately people think peaches and cream or just peaches for dessert, but I want to really highlight them in some sort of a savory way. So my brain immediately starts just spinning and the wood starts burning about how can I use peaches in a different way.
All right. Well, let's start picking.
Cool. Let's do it.
Yeah.
So we've spent a lot of time on land. We've gotten a lot of great things for the dinner. Now it's time to get into the ocean and see what else we can gather. We went paragliding, we grabbed some peaches and pepino dolce, and now it's time to meet up with Cody, a good friend of ours, and get into the water and do some spearfishing.
Watch your step, it's kind of loose gravel over here too.
I dive a lot on Maui and, you know, so I have my spots and you have little places where you always tend to go, but Cody, my buddy, he wants to take me to one of his spots and I'm super excited to get in the water.
Oh, it's looking better down here, Mike.
Yeah, it's a good little spot, kind of like in the lee of the wind.
In the month of Velo, as we're transitioning out of the wet season into the dry season, it's the time that nearshore fishing and spear fishing becomes more productive. Cody finds us a nice place to tuck in out of the wind because it is blasting down there, just like Velo tells us.
All right, let's do it.
See you ready.
Yeah. Cody's just amazing. I mean, he knows these waters like the back of his hand. He talks about going and spear fishing before he goes to work in the morning. And so I feel really, really comfortable getting in there with him. Get in the water and swim out to about 70, 80 feet depth, and Cody and Mike start chumming the water with these little fish bits. They start floating down to the bottom.
So Palu's floating everywhere, sinking down to the bottom. All the little reef fish are, you know, all over it, eating it, but we're waiting for the big boys to come from underneath.
And I'm thinking to myself, like, now what's the biggest thing that's gonna come in right over there? Because I can't see around me over here.
We wait for the palu to get close to the bottom and then, you know, we breathe up and dive down. Spearfishing is all about being stealthy, being quiet, hunting. It's you're hunting underwater and you're hunting an animal who's way tuned in to your movements, your general vibe. Really, when you go down, and it's all about remaining calm, stealthy, and I happened to be on a short breath hold, and Papil swam by, and I had a good shot, and I took it, and I got him.
Mike and Cody are out there dropping down to like 60, 70 feet. And they're shooting some uku, some papillo, some big boys down there, and I can't do that. I'm in the shallows, poking around in the pukas, and I see a taco, octopus, so I go after him and try and tickle him out with my spear gun and get him to start coming out, but he's giving me some heat. I'm having a lot of trouble getting the taco out of the hole, so I call Cody over. He comes down and he knows the technique, and it's all about patience. You gotta be able to hold your breath to be patient 20 feet under the water. And so he tickles the taco and gets it to come out of the hole, and he comes up with it. When you get a taco out of its hole, it's gonna do a couple things. Try and get away, or it's gonna start crawling up your arm. And it starts crawling up Cody's arm. He gets it out, and you know, the way you take care of a taco is you flip it inside out, or you get in there and you bite it. It's the cleanest, fastest, easiest, most humane way to do it. And Cody knows the trick. He gets right in there, flips it inside out, and bites the brain.
It was the prime opportunity for the master, Cody Varas, to come over and try to kind of show his skills.
We've been in there for hours now, and it's time to get out. We get out of the water, and you know, we got the taco, and you see Cody and Mike just loaded with the pupio, the ufu, the cole. We got some good fish for the dinner, but you know, the other great bounty from the ocean is limu, seaweed, and Cody knows just the perfect spot to go get some native limu that'll be perfect for the dinner. Just finished spear fishing, and we hop on over to this other spot that Cody knows is perfect for limu kohu. So we get there down to the coast and kind of eye out where we're gonna go. Right on, Cody, this is the spot?
Yeah, this is the spot. You said you wanted to look for some limu kohu, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Well, we're here.
Nice, dude. I really wanted to see if we could go get some native limu kohu, and Cody was like, yeah, I know the spot where we can get some of that.
Cody's gonna take us to this spot, but it's not right on the shore. And although there is a bunch of limu, of seaweed on shore, this place you actually gotta get in the ocean, swim out a few hundred yards, and swim down the coast for a little bit to find the limu kohu that we're looking for. In ancient Hawaii, limu was our salad. That's where we got all our micronutrients from, and there were tons of different types of limu. Now, a host of problems like invasive limu and also destruction of habitat have made finding native limu really difficult. But Cody's got a spot, and limu kohu is a really delicious variety. You just see this limu kohu down there just kind of fluttering in the ocean current like a fern fluttering in the breeze. And it's so nice to dive down there about 8 to 10 feet of water and just pick this limu up. Native limu is one of those sources that you really want to protect for future generations, but you also want the current generation to know what it tastes like. And it's all about how you gather it and making sure that that root that sticks onto that piece of coral stays there, and you just pinch it off and take the leaf, but not the root, leaving more to grow for the next guy.
I'd never gone and actually gotten kohu before. I've seen limu kohu before. Really excited to get it and experience of it, eating it. I've never prepared it though, so as a chef, you know, it being such a significant cultural thing, it's gratifying. It's super gratifying to see native limus in their natural habitat, you know, as opposed to invasives. Went spearfishing, got just enough limu. Cody took his to friends and family. We took ours, and excited to get into the kitchen and start playing around with some really fun ideas I have.
So we've gathered some really amazing ingredients, pepino dolce and peaches up on the mountain, and fish and limu down in the ocean. Now it's time for Mike to get in the kitchen and start cooking.
So One of the dishes that I'm going to make is a lomi with the limu kohu from our dive and also a he'e that we caught on our dive yesterday. If you ask people, there's a million different ways they'll have to prepare he'e. This is the way that we're going to do it today. First step is we're going to put our he'e in a cold pot covered on high heat for 5 minutes. We're then going to take the he'e out and cool it on a platter, clean our he'e. We'll put the he'e back into the pot with the liquid and a little bit of vinegar, and we'll simmer that for 45 minutes to an hour. This is our limu kohu, and what we've done is we've cleaned it really well. We've packed it in salt overnight, and now basically it'll last forever. We're gonna take a small piece of the limu, and a little of this stuff goes a long way, so we're just gonna take a little bit, we're gonna chop it up. Next, we're gonna mix our limu with our he'e and papillo lomi, and we're also gonna throw in some shaved Maui onions, a little bit of cilantro, mint, and green onion. Next, we'll add our limu. We're gonna grate some ginger. Add some shoyu. Add some sesame oil. Just mix it up. Season with salt and pepper. Mix it together, season it to taste, and then it's good to go. With our fish that we caught spearfishing, we're going to make a sweet and spicy Olinda peach with Thai basil sauce. The first step is to juice some citrus. We got some beautiful oranges up here, limes, calamansi. We're gonna take some of our peaches and we're gonna cut those up and then blend them very gently with some of the citrus juice. So once the juices and the peach are pureed in the blender, we're going to add that to the pot that has the ginger, garlic, and shallots in it. And we're just gonna put that through a strainer as we add it, just to get some of that peach pulp out. After you have all the juices in the pot, we're gonna reduce that slowly by about a quarter to a half. Then we're going to strain it and then reserve it until we're ready to finish it right before we serve it. Fish are plated. The last thing we have to do is just finish the sauce. And we got it at consistency. We're gonna finish it with the peaches, some shaved jalapenos, and Thai basil leaves. So the final step is we're just gonna sauce the fish. We're just gonna put the sauce all over the fish.
Peaches, you can eat right off the tree. Fish, you can have raw with poke limu. You can eat it raw, but that's not what this is about. This is about Mike being able to be himself, be creative, and really do something amazing with these ingredients.
So using the pepino dolce that we got from Forest and Kim, we're going to make a horchata, pepino dolce horchata. And the first step is to puree water, sugar, and rice in a blender. After you puree with the water, you'll add the pepino dolce melon, some ground cinnamon, a little bit of coconut milk, adjust the taste to your liking. Then after you have it to your liking, you'll pass through a strainer, some cheesecloth, or a nut milk bag. So then season it to taste and put it in the fridge and get it nice and cold. Kim had mentioned how her and Forrest like to make agua fresca with the pepino dolce after working outside all day. Like an Arnold Palmer is iced tea and lemonade, we're gonna do the same with agua fresca and horchata. While the horchata is cooling in the fridge, we're gonna make a fruit salad to go with it, and we're gonna start by dicing our pepino dolce. So we're gonna add some other fruits to go with the pepino dolce. We're gonna add some grapefruit, peaches, yacon, some strawberries, lime juice, and mint. Final step for the horchata is we're just gonna place everything into the bowl. We're gonna start with our fruit salad, finish with our horchata, garnish with a little bit of herbs and fennel pollen, and be done.
Mike's been in the kitchen putting together something amazing. I got off the hook this time without having to chop too much stuff. And guests are arriving. It's getting down to the wire. It's time to start serving some dinner. Not only are we on Maui and the island I was born and raised on, but we're also at my home. And Summer and I are expecting a little one on the way. Forrest and Kim and the parents are coming over, and so it's just a good old family dinner.
So here we have it. This is our kole and our uku that we spear dove and caught with just a little rice on the bottom and the Olinda peach, the sweet and spicy Olinda peach sauce with Thai basil, and a lomi of he'e with limu kohu.
It's dinner time now.
Let's eat.
Red dill, then a fennel.
Yeah.
Coming through.
Fennel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The peaches are such a contrast. Unlikely.
I got that nice tang to them. Mm-hmm. Goes well with the sweetness.
And it's a savory rather than a sweet flavor. Yeah.
And they feel really tender.
Just really delicious, Mike. Like a 5-star meal.
Thank you so much.
It was an honor to taste such a fine meal from the peaches that I had grown. I mean, peaches and fish? I mean, who would have thought of that?
Alrighty, so something sweet. It's with the pepino dolce, some of your peaches in there, as well as some other local fruits. Enjoy.
Dig in here, sir.
Thank you.
All right.
There's so many flavors in there. It's almost like hard to pin them all down.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's not heavy.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. So it's actually very refreshing.
Yeah.
It's like, what am I eating? It's wonderful.
Yeah.
There's nothing like searching your home and bringing it home. Thank you for watching Search Hawaii, where food meets culture. And you can find Chef Mike's recipes online at searchhawaiitv.com. Aloha.
Search Hawaii, where food meets culture, is brought to you by Grand Wailea, a Waldorf Astoria resort on Maui. We live to create extraordinary lifetime memories. With transportation provided by Hawaiian Airlines.